Good evening. It's Thursday, January 24th, 6 p.m., and this is the work session meeting of the Newburgh City Council. Do we have a motion to go into executive session?
So move.
Second.
All in favor? Aye. All right.
Aye.
Yep.
All right. So the first item up.
We need a motion to come out of executive session.
Motion to come out of executive session.
So move.
Thank you.
Second.
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 All in favor?
Aye.
All right. We have a number of presentations this evening. The first is the Land Bank's annual presentation to the council. And what I will say is it will be a wonderful presentation for many reasons. So Madeline, thank you for all that you have done, and I look forward to this.
Thank you.
Hey, you.
Hi, Madeline.
I would.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, ma'am. So thank you for having me on the agenda tonight. I just wanted to do a few things, just sort of give you a little bit of an update. You know, the Land Bank Act, as you know, we are accountable to the municipality, so we do give an annual presentation. So I'm kind of go over 2018 and sort of how we did on 2018, and give you a little overview of what's coming up in the next year or so, and absolutely to answer any questions that you might have. So we put together sort of a brief review. We try to let you know, the numbers tell the story as much as we're able. But in sort of short summary, in 2018, we saw a lot of sort of projects come to fruition. The first phase of our big push for historic renovations with the partner REPCO developer was complete. So 45 units of housing and historically renovated properties were complete and fully occupied, primarily by residents of the city of Newburgh. We also were able to start construction on our 15th Habitat property, the 15th building that we've partnered with them on. We had a number of additional sales to homeowners and to private investors alike, both local and people sort of coming to the area. We generated on those sales, and again, keeping in mind a lot of this is pre-rehab value, but about $170,000 to the city in taxation. That doesn't include the school taxes. You can see in the summary there's just a map just that kind of demonstrates the footprint that the Land Bank has had. You can see sort of the concentration that we've made in the sort of north of Broadway neighborhood between Broadway and First and west of Liberty Street. And we also have some new board members. As you are all aware, you appointed Ramona Monteverde as your city council representative on the board of directors, our new interim city manager, Joe Donat, as well as Allie Church as in her capacity as the distressed property task force chair. Just to look comprehensively, on the back, a few other highlights. We were able to participate on the Center for Community Progress, who's sort of the national clearinghouse for distressed property initiatives, highlighted some of the work that we've been able to do around creative placemaking and sort of artistic endeavors as a way to sort of build a neighborhood's profile. We were able to participate in a learning exchange with other similarly situated communities, which was a fun experience that we were able to have. And looking ahead, we also secured an additional $2 million in funding for 2019 and 2020 to implement a new work plan. Do you have a question?
And that's exactly where I was going to go, so that's a nice segue. And so what are the goals for 2019?
Sure. So we're shifting gears a little bit. Over the past several years, in the funds that we've invested over $6.5 million, primarily in stabilization, abatement, and preparing properties, evaluating properties, and preparing them for sale. You know, the large, you know, a lot of them, both to Habitat, to REPCO, and to individuals. This year, we're actually looking ahead at concentrating on other types of homeownership opportunities. We love what Habitat does, and we've been able to do a lot of sales to sort of the more do-it-yourself, you know, home buyers. But we've looked at other models around that seem to have been successful. And so one of the things that we're going to be doing and focusing a lot of the energy at the land bank on is two-family home ownership with a supportive rental unit. We think that this is a good way to both, we're able to heavily subsidize the construction, we'll be overseeing the development of the scopes of work and the construction, and then working with people who wish to become homeowners of lower and moderate income, and that will also have a rental unit to help defray the costs of taxes, the maintenance of a historic home, and that kind of stuff. We'll partner up on homeownership education and counseling. We're also working with Sunnie Mae to make loans available to people that might not be traditionally credit worthy to try to open up opportunities for people. We've met with a lot of people in the neighborhood where we work that are traditionally not able to access a typical mortgage. So we're working with Sunnie Mae to also create opportunities for people whose credit might fall underneath those traditional levels.
Question, Madeline, sure. Are you following, and you might have mentioned this, the same model that Habitat uses? Like, you know, there's the budgeting workshop that they provide so that people get ready to, you know, budget themselves for the taxes and their mortgage and...
So we're going to have them partner. So we're going to use partners because similar to the way, Habitat, I think, does a lot in-house, but they also partner with Pathstone. So we're working both with Pathstone and with REPCO's Orange County Homeownership Counseling Arm. They already know how to do it well. They're HUD certified. And so they're also able to make connections for people to other opportunities for down payment and closing cost assistance, savings programs that provide matching dollars. You know, there's a Federal Home Loan Bank savings program that'll match, you know, $3 to every dollar you save. So we're just sort of trying to make those connections to make sure that people are getting, you know, the Mount St. Mary sort of potential grant dollars and all of those kinds of things.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful.
In addition to that, again, because we're going to oversee all the construction and all of those things, there's only so many that we can undertake. We're trying for 5 or 6 in the year for the year. We're going to also be doing our more traditional thing of stabilization, abatement, and then preparing properties for renovation. We manage, we maintain a mailing list, so people who come into our office, people who submit inquiries on our website, people who call, we maintain an ongoing list so that when we have opportunities, we can circulate them really widely. We also have another application pending for additional rental development with REPCO, so we're holding those buildings and maintaining them. We also have a couple of we have some funding available to help Habitat do another 5 or 6 properties. Are there any other questions or details that I could sort of help clarify for anyone? Or
I'm trying because I think all of us, if not most of us, have taken several tours and have met with you so many times. So I'm trying to think of questions that the community might want to know, but I can't right now. So
okay.
I do want to publicly tell people that the office is located on Chamber Street. I forget the address right
it's
now.
It's 15 Chamber Street.
15
so right
Chamber,
off of Broadway.
The old Bruce Hodges,
yeah.
For home. They did a very great job with that. And so whenever they're open, please stop by. The staff is very friendly, very welcoming, and they will explain everything that the land bank does in case someone has questions about what they do, why they do it, how they do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we're there, and we're pretty open for visitors. One last thing also, again, if just for public information, we're working on a couple of different projects that are going to be sort of upcoming in the short term. We did raise funds in 2017 that we've been working on expending over the past year and going into this into 2019. We have two programs. One is called Neighbors for Neighborhoods, which is a program for locally owned rental property, so that if someone's sort of a homeowner on a block and is interested in taking on potentially becoming a small-scale landlord, you can't own more than two other properties. But we are currently renovating 167 North Miller through that funding, which is from Enterprise Community Partners, and we're going to issue a request for proposals in probably by March, depending on how the construction continues on through the winter. And so that'll be a local opportunity for local ownership of rental housing. It comes with landlord training as well, so you can kind of learn about being a good landlord. And then there will also be, as they talked about the two family opportunities, the first of those will also be ready sort of toward the end of spring. So we're going to start probably in March again, advertising those properties. Once the framing and sheetrocking and basic stuff is done, you know, we'll be able to start having those available for people to take a look at and sort of evaluate whether whether they're homes that they might want to live in. So those are things that are sort of coming up in the shorter term.
What was the other organization? You said Neighbors for Neighborhoods. What was the other one?
That's a funding program, Neighbors for Neighborhoods. It's a funding program created by Enterprise Community Partners, who's providing a lot of funding and technical assistance in communities like Newburgh and all over the country. But we have a special grant program that was facilitated through some of the Attorney General settlement dollars. And the idea behind the Neighbors for Neighborhoods program, which exists here through the land bank, but also in Albany, Schenectady, Syracuse, and one or two other communities throughout upstate New York, to create locally owned small-scale rental opportunities. So as opposed to just home ownership, it enables someone who doesn't own a lot of rental housing to own small-scale a couple of, you know, units, two buildings. And so that's an opportunity that we're hoping that people in Newburgh will be able to take advantage of.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Madeline.
And if it's okay, I just want to share that tomorrow is your last day. And congratulate you on, you know, your new endeavors. And
thank you.
Wish you luck.
Thank you so much. Yeah, so I will be leaving the land bank. I'm going to work at the state level on these kinds of issues at a policy level, and hopefully still being able to be involved with Newburgh, but lots of other places.
Well, don't go.
Congratulations.
It's been an incredible, incredible almost 10 years of my life here, and wow. I'll miss the people most of all, and I'll miss the buildings that I love.
So who's going to meet a new Madeline?
That will be forthcoming. Yes. There's been a process, an ongoing process to identify someone in Newburgh to take on that role. So.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Big shoes to fill.
Thank you,
Madeline. It's been great working with you for the last 6 years. I wish you best of luck moving forward. The next presentation we have is from Damien from Impact.
Hello.
Hey. So, yeah, and then they could pass it down.
What's that?
I was going to say,
yeah,
then they could pass it.
Yeah, handle the bulk of it, and we'll just pass it down.
Yeah, that way it saves time. Yeah.
Thanks.
So while he's going over there, I'll give a brief introduction to Mr. DePauw. I met him about 5 years ago, his lovely wife, his mother, his father, and now he just recently had a young daughter. I met him he was doing some work with We Are Newburgh, and so once I started volunteering with them, he was with them. And now he recently has his own organization, Impact, that stands for individuals, something it stands for. And then he can explain that. It usually, every single time when he works at right across from 123 Grand at that white building, what's that address there?
135
in the white building. What's it?
It's an independent living.
Independent living.
And the name
thank
of
you.
The program is Onward Recovery.
Onward Recovery.
We do peer mentoring with people with substance use disorders and mental health disorders, and we employ people who are in recovery themselves and have lived, been able to overcome some of their symptoms, and we help people on their road to recovery.
Right. Now, let me ask you really quickly, because I got a call from Westchester where their family services is looking to support financially an organization in the city of Newburgh that deals with families and young people transitioning back into society. And they knew about Exodus, so they weren't interested in that. Does your organization deal with teenagers 19 to 25 that were formerly incarcerated and transitioning back? Is there a mentor program with that target audience?
We do not do reentry specifically. So we work with only adults, so 18 and above.
Oh.
But we can work with 18, so 19 young adults. But it's around substance use and mental health diagnoses.
I may have to make the referral, because there's funding.
Absolutely.
They got money that they want to help give to our community for that. We'll talk. Yeah, if there's a but they were looking for an existing program mentoring teens from 19 to 25.
Okay.
So, okay.
And I'd love to talk.
Right. Okay.
Absolutely.
And I don't want to take up too much of his presentation time, but that's what I was going to mention about Mr. DePauw. Every single time when I'm thinking of a concept or idea and I want to do something in the neighborhood, I'll usually go across the street and talk to him, and he's either already started it or he was thinking about it. So it's just really, we just really jive together.
So, thank you so much.
Before you start, can I ask one more question?
Sure.
So Impact Inc., is this totally separate from We Are Newburgh?
It is.
Okay.
It is. It kind of spawned out of We Are Newburgh, so
okay.
I'll get started. So my name is Damian DePauw, as Mr. Gray said, and I started Impact Incorporated. Now, Impact Incorporated stands for Individuals Making Positive Advancements in Their Communities Together. And I've worked in the nonprofit field for about 19, 20 years.
Right.
So since I was 21, and I'm 40, so 19 years. And I've done a lot of work in the community as well with We Are Newburgh. Mm-hmm. And one of the most inspiring things to me in doing that work has been people who come forward and say, hey, I support what you guys are doing. How can I help? Put me to work. I can help cook. I can clean. I can hand out water. I can do this, that. You know, I think a lot of people here have been to We Are Newburgh events and have been willing to lend a hand and contribute. Mm-hmm. So the whole concept behind Impact Incorporated is average everyday people have skills and abilities that can be contributed to the greater good in such a way that if we all did it just for 3 to 5 hours a month, it would change our community overnight. So the mission of Impact Incorporated is to increase civic engagement in impoverished neighborhoods. And the vision really is to inspire people to get up and do something about things that resonate with them specifically. So, for example, I don't know much about muscular dystrophy, but somebody has been touched by that, and they have skills and abilities that can be contributed to an organization who's already addressing that issue. And the mission of Impact Incorporated really is to help people learn how they can use their own skills and abilities to contribute to something that they believe in. It doesn't have to be with our organization. It could be with any other nonprofit or any other movement organization within the community. So I kind of got this concept. I studied asset-based community development. And asset-based community development basically says that before you create something new and put a lot of money into it and hire a lot of people to try and address a specific problem, you look at the assets that a community already has and you say, how can we leverage these assets to address this issue? And a lot of times you can come up with some creative solutions on how you can address something without having to invest a lot of money or hire a lot of people and so on and so forth.
Yeah,
I have also studied up on sharing economies.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that I think it's really great that you're using the ABCD model out of DePaul University, and it'd be great if we were able to get a cohort to go to some of the institute trainings that they have. Because I think embedding this type of philosophy, right, from starting from the asset-based is crucial to, I think, having the charity model to empowerment model shift here in the city of Newburgh.
Yes, I agree completely. And that would be a great opportunity for some people to do, to actually go and study it. I might want to myself.
Yeah, so yeah, we should continue.
Okay. So I've also studied up on sharing economies. So this is the mission and the vision. This is the actual stated version. I kind of gave a synopsis of this. I won't take too much time on that. But if you guys are interested in learning more about Impact Incorporated, we did create a website with the help of Pratt Institute. So they had a design core. It was an in-kind pro bono grant that we were able to get. And they had a whole group of 17 students and two teachers that worked on a design campaign for us. So one of the things they did is they helped us create a website. And that was, they did a really great job with that. I'm really impressed by it. But what I'm here to talk about today is the Together We Can time bank. So how many people here have heard of a time bank, by show of hands? Okay, so a few people. Most people have not. So when I first started working, doing things with We Are Newburgh, I said, you know, we need some kind of program to help people help other people without expecting money the way it used to be done. When somebody's car would break down, your neighbor would come out, right? And your neighbor would say, oh, I'll call my brother Joe. My brother Joe knows about cars. He might be able to help you with that kind of thing. And nowadays, that neighborliness has been lost from not just Newburgh, but from society in general. It's not the way it used to be. So time banking is, now I started working with We Are Newburgh. I started going out filling out asset-based inventories with people. And nobody wanted to fill out my surveys. And I went around and I wanted to start something called Hood Help, but I didn't have the ability to link people's skills and abilities with other people's needs. So I said I would have to be a computer programmer and start some kind of program or some kind of online platform. So I put it on the shelf for a couple of years, and recently I was talking to someone about it and they said you should look into time banking. So time banking already has all of that established. So if you go to timebanks.org, the one that we started for Newburgh is www.togetherwecan.timebanks.org. And the way it works is people get rewarded for any time they spend doing acts of service to others. And they bank those hours in the time bank. So for example, Mayor Harvey, if you needed help, if you hurt your back and I offered to shovel your driveway when it snows, mm-hmm. I could earn, for every hour I spent shoveling your driveway, that's one time credit I would get in the system. I can then go into the system and spend that time credit for whatever I need help with. So I might have a leaky faucet and I don't have the money to hire a plumber. But somebody else in the time bank, they have a skill of plumbing, and they say, oh, I can help you with that. Wow. So I list that on the platform, on the website, and say, I need help with this, and somebody else responds to my need. And the circles of giving go on and on through the community, and none of it relies on money. That's the beautiful part. And
it's really, I like that.
Yeah, thank
you. It's amazing.
It is. And what it really, what kind of the neatest thing about it is, it builds community. This makes people meet other people that they wouldn't normally meet within their own community, and it crosses racial divides, socioeconomic divides, age divides, you know, gender divides, whatever it may be. You meet other people through this concept. So I just want to show you, now I'm going to skip ahead. I don't want to take too much time here. This is a short video on YouTube that shows exactly how, in Japan, they've been doing this for years, and they actually use it as a retirement system called Furiya Kipu. Now, people commit acts of service throughout their entire lifetime to other people, number one, because it's the right thing to do, but number two, because when they become elderly, they use all of their banked hours to do things, to have other people do things for them that they can't do anymore, to remain independent in the community. So, if you can, uh-oh.
Is it gonna?
Click that off.
Is that it?
Icon.
There's a little X that you'll have to hit in the corner of that advertisement. There you go.
Damien, I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. The video is 6 minutes long. Is that?
Yeah, that's not gonna.
We oftentimes have a 10-minute time restriction on the presentations.
Okay.
If you want, you could supply this, and I'll be certain to send it to the council, and I'd also be happy to meet further with you about this.
That's
matter,
fine. The only thing I want to mention is that at the end of this video, so it shows Furia Kipu in Japan. What it also shows is the time banking system that exists in Australia. And in Australia, they have 6,100 time banking members, and it's an actual government-sponsored program. So when needs arise within the community, a natural disaster hits, whatever it might be, they put out a blast and say, we need help with this, we need help with that. So I'm trying to build this over time, and if I'm successful, if I get 300-400 people in the city of Newburgh to join this time bank, you know, as things come across your desk, just ask yourself, if there were volunteers that were willing to do something about this issue, you know, how could I leverage that? How could I leverage their assets and their skills and abilities without having to spend too much money and rely on them to help with this issue? Because there's a lot of community-minded people who want to help, who want to do some things, and this is a platform that can really address a lot of different issues.
So really quickly, of course, I'm a member of the Time Bank, and we have been trying to work with some organizations on getting them to adopt this. And so I don't want to reveal all of that, but also I want to mention that under Impact, we also have the STAR project. I'm saying that like I'm on your board of Impact, right? We also have the STAR project, and what the STAR project does is businesses can donate. So of course, Perfect Suites has donated to the STAR project, and it's in certain restaurants and other places so that when people come in and they need a warm something, and they don't have the cash, the STAR project allows them to be able to get that item from that.
It's a pay it forward system. Yeah. So yeah, you can purchase a bagel or a slice of pizza,
yeah,
put a note on the bulletin board, and then someone who is in need can then come in, pull it down, read what you wrote, and turn it in for something to eat. And in addition to that, there's resource booklets for substance use, housing, and a variety of other issues that are for things that exist already in the city of Newburgh to support people who might need that kind of help.
Excellent.
So thank you.
Is there a
thank
contact
you so much.
Number?
You
have
I'm
a
sorry?
Contact number?
I
do
say
you have a contact number. Number?
I do, sure. It might be on the back of that, possibly not, but it's 845-432-4033.
Damien, I know when we spoke on Halloween, I'm sorry, I have laryngitis. You said you were getting your 501c3. Did you get it yet?
We have to file for it. So,
because once you file, you're in. I mean, you know, you have to wait for them to accept it, but get your application in to the IRS.
Yeah, yeah.
Even though they're closed right
now. I'm waiting. We have a small mini grant coming that's going to cover the cost of paying for the application. So I'm just waiting for that to come in, and then we're going to be sending
that'll
it out.
Help you a lot.
Yes, yes. Thank you so much.
And I'm going to text you that name and number of the gentleman in Westchester.
Okay.
So you can connect with him and see if what you do in mentoring fits what they are looking for so you can get the funding.
I'd love to speak to him. Thank you so much
My
for
pleasure.
Thinking of me of that.
My pleasure, man.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you, Damian.
Thank you.
Okay. Next up, we have a presentation from Manager O'Green regarding the power issues facing the Hudson Valley. Ms. Green, while you were out, I had to remind Damian, and I just want to give you the pleasure of reminding you as well. We oftentimes try and keep a 10-minute maximum on presentations here.
Okay. So, and this is not going to be deducted from your 10 minutes. I just wanted to do a quick introduction to Honorable Manager Green. She's the legislator from District 19 in Ulster County. She's also the environmental director for the Hudson River Sloop Clearwater, as well as a lot of other accomplishments here in the Hudson Valley. I will say that she's also the deputy chair of Public Works and Capital Projects Committee, and I'd be happy to share her full CV to the rest of the council afterwards. But and what we're going to talk about in, you know, 10 minutes, probably not the whole breadth of the depth that this, you know, huge environmental issue that's coming down our pipeline, no pun there, but just maybe the highlights of what are some of the action steps. I know that you guys met yesterday, and this is a continuation of several meetings that have taken place. And thank you very much for the sort of outline that you've given that I think, you know, we can all go through it on our own time. But the pertinent slides, Ms. Green, would be, you know, what I'd like to spend some time on.
I want to just, if I may, take and thank you for that very comprehensive introduction. And I am clearly wearing my Clearwater hat this evening. Clearwater is very, very concerned about the global climate crisis, and we absolutely want to prevent further fossil fuel infrastructure and instead believe that that money, whether it's public money or private funds, should be invested in renewable energy infrastructure with storage and efficiency. And that's where we need to go. It's in all kinds of goals, but we really have to start implementing it. And so I'm just going to take a few minutes and point out a few interesting highlights, and then take any questions and answer your question about potential action. So the I have to remember to advance this, which would be this way. No, it's from here to.
You had it the first time, actually.
Oh wait, I have to aim it that way. Okay, good. The coal-fired days, and you know, people in this area are generally familiar with the fact that Danskammer was built primarily as a coal plant and has a very large coal ash landfill on the site, and there are environmental and potential health problems associated with that. But that's going to be there no matter what happens with the Danskammer expansion. And then in 2011, I believe, with Superstorm Sandy, Danskammer was completely inundated, and there was serious flooding to the facility. And it was closed, and it was determined by the New York Independent System Operators, which are the people that are responsible for reliability on the grid. They had written off Danskammer as a mothballed facility. At the same time, the Federal Energy Reserve Regulatory Commission decided that it was necessary to incentivize additional capacity, generating capacity here in the Lower Hudson Valley, and they passed what was called the Lower Hudson Valley Capacity Zone, where they would give an incentive to a company that was willing to build additional capacity here in the Hudson Valley, primarily because there's such a demand for it in the greater New York metropolitan area, and a bottleneck above us
That makes it a little hard to bring energy from Western New York. Unfortunately, they didn't tie any special incentives for that to be renewable energy. Basically, Wall Street took that as a signal to reinvest in Danskammer, which they did. They brought it back on as a gas-fired plant with an oil backup. And you can see that over time.
Where is it located?
Yes.
By
the way, I'm very hard of hearing, and for some reason it's harder tonight. So please use your mic and speak loud for me.
Okay, gotcha.
Did somebody?
Yeah, no, the mayor was asking the location of it.
The exact
location
just, of it.
Right, it's in the town of Newburgh, and I don't know the exact address.
So when you go.
Yes, it's in the town. Am I facing the water?
Yeah,
is
this
here.
Way. It would
north.
Be this way.
Oh, I got turned around.
Water's.
Okay. So basically, it's a couple miles up the Hudson River. When you go across the Beacon Newburgh Bridge, you can see both Roseden and Danskammer. And in one of the pictures, I'll show you the relationship. It is also on a peninsula that sticks out into the Hudson River, and that's why it is so flood-prone. If it were on a slope, and Roseden is well out of a potential floodplain, but Danskammer is right down on a peninsula in the Hudson River, and I think the most important thing I want to say on this slide, and I only have a few slides, is that I mentioned this capacity zone. Well, when the Wall Street investors reopened the facility as a peaker plant, they are earning $10 to $20 million profit a year for a facility that by their own, and I double-checked this at the open house, their own estimation is that it operates less than 5% of the year. So that's how strong that financial incentive was to bring this back online. It is burning gas. It's still using Hudson River water, and that's a clear water issue because it results in fish kill, Hudson River water for the cooling system. And it also generates a lot of emissions that are air emissions that affect people with respiratory conditions and also greenhouse gases. But it's only running 5% or less a year. The proposed expansion is to build another facility and retire that brick-looking structure on the right of the slide. And use it for another purpose or take it down. They haven't really decided, and they don't need to right away. But they propose to build another facility. Now, that facility, this is the long chain of ownership. You can read that. By the way, on this picture, you can see what I mean by it being a peninsula sticking out into the river. There's no elevated area. They can try to build a berm, but it's still going to be a peninsula in the river and a very flood-prone area, so much so that it's already been essentially destroyed once and built back. There we go. I wanted to, I'm going to go back because I think this is worth pointing out. On this slide, I did say, I explained the capacity payments. This is a long chain of ownership. And this is what is proposed. And that 3-mile radius is all of the people in that 3-mile radius around that facility had to be notified as part of their public information process, and have been, and they held four open houses, and unfortunately, rather than having a meeting where everybody could hear each other, there were little stations, and that's getting to be very popular with developers. It's kind, from our perspective, it's somewhat of a divide and conquer, because you don't get to hear other people's questions and comments. I did learn a lot. For one thing, I thought this was going to be 100% year-round baseload facility. It's going to run 60 to 70% of the time, not less than 5% of the time. And that's why it's going to end up burning more fossil fuel and producing more emissions, even with better emission control devices. And that's something they're going to have to explain in their application. The other thing is, once you build a new plant rather than a renovated older facility, it's going to be here for a long time. And so that's why we're concerned about investing in more fossil fuel infrastructure. The other thing, they will no longer be taking Hudson River water. They're going to use an air-cooled system. So that's a benefit. And, you know, Clearwater takes pride in our credibility that we recognize something that's positive, but in the net, we think this is a very foolhardy investment, and one that's going to have real effects on the city of Newburgh, which is already plagued with PFOS and lead and other pollution, and has high rates of respiratory illness, et cetera, asthma. So it's one thing to have a peaker plant that runs less than 5% of the year in a very vulnerable location, which will probably, you know, we hope to never see another superstorm. But realistically, we're not going to be able to stop sea level rise, and we are very definitely going to be having more severe storms, and that could result in storm surges.
So, Ms. Green, I think everybody, I don't want to speak for everybody, but I'm also just watching the time as well. I think there's full support from the council. You were talking about some of the impact, environmental, you know, justice issues that will plague the city of Newburgh as one of the sort of, catchment areas, right? I mean, I think we're just a little bit outside of that official circle that they've, you know, put, and I think that was a misstep from the way that they're, you know, informing the neighbors, because it is an artificial sort of cutoff that they've done. So I really appreciate, what Clearwater has been doing in terms of, like, engaging and educating our residents and our community on it. And I know that maybe if we can transition to the resolution, that I know that is, you know, one of the sort of action items that we want to have a full discussion from the council. So I think it was in folks' packages for us to just, you know, spend maybe the next 3 minutes on that, and then it would be up for a vote on Monday.
Okay. This is the summary there, and there's one other picture I want to show you. I want to point out that Roseden, as you can see, is up on a higher elevation. Look particularly at the lower right picture. Dan Scammer's on the far right on the peninsula. Roseden is up higher. However, it's a larger facility. It's a very dirty facility, and it does use a lot of Hudson River water and has those impacts. But this proposal is for Dan Scammer, and that's what we're focused on. But in terms of the city of Newburgh, there are cumulative impacts. And that doesn't get addressed very well in applications. And in this case, by the way, what the plant needs to go through is an Article 10 process, which is designed specifically for larger energy facilities, and it takes all of the other, you know, CEQA and all of the other processes and puts it into one-stop shopping. And last night, Haley Carlock from Scenic Hudson provided an overview, which I will send I guess to Naomi to send to the board and the city manager. Then, of course, the big issue is climate change. And again, you can see how flat and how low this facility is, and that's true for the whole property. This is what I wanted to be sure you could see. Scenic Hudson has developed a sea level rise mapper to help municipalities assess what they should or shouldn't do on their waterfront. And in the upper left is that Danskammer Peninsula with 1 foot of sea level rise. You can barely see that. But moving across, that's 3 foot. You start to see a little bit of inundation. By 4 foot, a good portion of the facility is inundated, and essentially the whole facility is underwater by 6 foot. Now, we don't know how fast. It used to sound like 6 foot was a long ways away, but unfortunately the polar ice caps are melting much faster than when those predictions were already made. So one of the things we'll be probably doing is bringing more current information to the application, if an application is filed, and it's expected to be filed somewhere around February 8th. So it's very soon. They've done their public information process, and will be moving forward. These are an outline of the environmental and health impacts, and again, I don't want to necessarily go through each one, but I want to get to your question, Karen, of, you know, what the Common Council could do. One thing is, I think it's really important that your attorney understand about the Article 10 process. One of the things under Article 10 that doesn't exist, I don't think, in any other legislation is intervener funding, and you're a municipality that would be entitled to intervener funding. Haley is an expert on this, but some of that funding would be available for legal advice during the pre-application, it has a different name, but there's essentially a scoping, a pre-application scoping period, which once that application is filed, that's the stage we'll be in, and we'll be asking to review the outline of the application and give comment like any other scoping session. You can get legal advice around that, and you can also get legal and expert. You can hire experts with this intervener funding. So that, I think, is something really critical for Newburgh to think about and apply for. I expect that the town of Newburgh will as well, but I believe that there are three entities, and another entity, municipal entity, is the Marlboro School District, because this three-mile perimeter radius is includes the Marlboro School District, who rely heavily on Danskammer for taxes. None of those taxes, as you well know, come to the city of Newburgh. They go to the town of Newburgh and to Marlboro. And in Marlboro in particular, I know that they have a very strong environmental ethic, but they have to weigh what's going to happen with their school district. I think we really have to make climate change and not exacerbating climate change to be the highest priority. So the second thing is we've developed a municipal resolution for your consideration. You know, if you feel that, you know, that this facility will do more harm than good, than benefit, and particularly in terms of the potential environmental and health impacts for Newburgh, And we've outlined that, and I...
Thank you, Ms. Green. Do members of the City Council have any questions?
So first, I want to apologize to Manager Joe Green for missing your session last night. I was in an important meeting with Mayor Harvey, and then I had to get home, so I apologize for missing. I do want to say that I have known Manager Joe Green for about a year now, and so we talk often about environmental issues, and we talk often about policy. So I'm looking forward to this. I've read through it. It doesn't seem to be anything that, you know, it seems to be right in line with some of our conversations that we've had. And so for me personally, I can see myself supporting this. So I want to thank you for your time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, moving forward to the planning and economic development portion of the meeting, we have a resolution amending the terms and the conditions of the sale of 60 Hasbrook Street.
In November, the council approved the sale of this property to Michael Levon for the amount of $50,000. Unfortunately, after the resolution was adopted and before the parties had an opportunity to close, there was some vandalism in the property and caused some substantial damage. The buyer is still interested in going through with the purchase, has invested in obtaining an estimate for the repairs to the damaged portion that occurred in this interim period, and has made a request for a reduction in the purchase price in the amount of the estimate for the cost of repairs. So the original purchase price was $50,000. The reduction would be for a purchase price of $42,115. The cover letter of the purchaser's attorney and the estimate is in your packets. We still think moving forward with the sale is in the city's best interest. This property has been vacant for several years, and it was originally put up for sale through the real estate broker in July, and we were unable to find an interested owner-occupant purchaser. We've owned this property, the city's owned this property since 2015, so it's almost, it's 4 years now. And Mr. Levon was interested in purchasing the property, doing the renovation, and then trying to sell it to somebody who would live there going forward. So we're bringing this one amendment to your, for your approval.
Right, so this is a, that seems like a substantial amount of damage that was done to the property, and I can understand his position. What I'm hoping is that that I don't know if it's even possible, but that in the future we can make sure that once we sell the property, it's secured in some kind of way, either by the property owner or by us, so that this doesn't happen again.
Most of the properties that are unoccupied are boarded and they are secured. Sometimes this happens. It's unfortunate that of the timing of it, but we do try to keep tabs on the property. So I understand your concerns, but given that the city has owned the property for 4 years, we really do recommend that we proceed with the sale as amended.
I agree. We should probably move on this before anything else happens.
Right.
Can I ask a question on that?
Mm-hmm.
'Cause sometimes when we sell a house, it takes the closing a while to happen, and we're still responsible to maintain it. Can we have, and part of that is when they offer to buy it, you say yes, and between that time and the closing, that they be responsible for it? Because if it wasn't for the water department doing leak detection, we would have never found it.
You would have to do a pre-closing occupancy agreement. Those are complicated, and it would not have. I don't know that it would have changed anything, but it may change. You know, we try to get people to close as quickly as possible, and I just don't know that we can look at that. But I can't. I don't know that that's going to be as easy to facilitate as it sounds.
Okay.
I agree with George. I think we should at least look at it.
Right. I agree.
Thank you. Moving forward, we have the next item is surplus materials at 123 Grand, which Ellie will talk further about.
Hi. So as many of you know, we're doing a lot of cleaning at 123 Grand to facilitate the movement of the records. In one of the rooms in the basement, it was stacked floor to ceiling with construction paper, and I'm not a teacher, so all the teachers explain these expensive big sheets of colored paper, like poster board things. You have photos of each of the room there. My understanding is this came from a grant that was given to the city many years ago. It was stored at South Lander Street. It's now stored in the basement of 123 Grand. We didn't want to throw it out. We reached out to Horizons, and the art teacher came with the principal and said, we will happily have this, but you all have no idea. This is, you know, a substantial amount of things, and the school district is going to require that both the city surplus it and then we accept the donation of the surplus. So this is a two-step project, which can hopefully get materials stored in a dusty basement to city elementary school children. So.
Great.
Awesome.
That was the 21st century learning grant.
Yes, that's my understanding.
Yeah, let's not talk about it.
I won't.
Any further questions?
No.
All right. Moving forward.
One quick question, Allie. So you said you're clearing out the basement. Where are all of our old records that Betsy used to take care of?
They're currently on the third floor of 123 Grand Street. Okay. They are stacked, each box just stacked on top of each other. It's a little bit of a mess. So what DPW has worked diligently is in clearing the basement, then cleaning the basement. The basement is watertight, so that's the first fear, is that it's a basement. We've gone through that. Yeah. So we're preparing the basement. We have found in various city buildings shelving units that Betsy had used. I don't know if anyone remembers when the records were at the armory. They're actually on shelving units. Those have been stored. So there's a whole process where we're putting the shelving back together. I say we, but of course it's DPW. I do none of this. And then we'll facilitate the moving in an orderly fashion of the records back onto the shelves.
What about all the records that were, when I went with Betsy and moved all Downing Park stuff a number of years ago, we went to like the water department. There was big pipes in the building, I remember.
Do you mean the Carter Street pump house?
I think that's what it was.
So right now, all that's in the Carter Street pump house are actually the shelves and the empty flat files. All of the records are either in 123 Grand. There have been some, we worked with BOCES and with Mary McTammany to figure out what are our most valuable records. Those are actually, we are now paying annually to put that in the new safe storage they have out at BOCES. So the very valuable things are there. There was a whole series of things that were, that the city no longer needed that went to state archives. So we are also going through, I would like to add, I am not the records manager. David Cole in my office is doing a lot of this. He's not the records manager either, but we've been greatly, greatly supported by BOCES and some funding we found to have BOCES help.
When Deirdre Glenn was here, she she recommended to the city to enter into a series of agreements with BOCES to come in and facilitate some of the training for the city staff and a high-level overview of the records that we do have, so that they can be records that can be destroyed can be properly destroyed, records that need to be preserved can be preserved in a very special manner and stored in a special location, and then other records that can be digitized should be digitized, and we're in the absence of a full-time record manager, many of the Planning and Development Department employees have been pitching in to help the rest of us as staff manage our records, and we're trying to get all of those records now into the basement of 123 Grant Street so that we can utilize the office space on the third floor of 123 Grant Street for that, for office purposes.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda, we're looking to amend the 2019 personnel book to add a full-time, eight-month neighborhood stabilization coordinator.
So the next two items relate to the same grant, so I'm going to briefly review the grant for you all. The city has received, at this point, phase two of a three-phase Cities Rise grant. Madeline, when she gave her presentation, talked about enterprise as a grantor to communities. The Planning and Development and the Codes Department have, again, received, this is now phase two of a three-phase grant to look at strategic code enforcement and how that affects distressed properties and improves distressed properties in our city. As part of that, for phase two, we are looking to hire a person to deep dive into this information. It has gone through civil service, and they've approved a job description based on an existing position in the city of Albany. You should all have that job description in front of you. And we're looking to hire for the term of phase two, which is 8 months. The hope is that, of course, we will receive phase three, and the person can continue for the extent after that. But this is a temporary adjustment to the 2019 personnel book.
How many phases altogether in RISE?
Three is my understanding.
It's a total.
Yes, total. Three, and phase three, as you may remember, is the big one.
Big one, yeah.
We're getting to.
Yep.
So the concern I have is that they must understand that once this grant is completed, that we, the city, don't want to be in a battle like we were with the firefighters.
So. Absolutely. So this is done as a temporary temporary position. So after 8 months, there's no guarantee of a position. The person would have to fully take it on knowing that.
Mm-hmm.
And again, you know, if you look at the experience, it's dropped considerably from the position that's in Albany, and some of it is because of that. We're hoping that an entry-level person will maybe take a risk on an eight-month.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Okay, so I can move on to the next portion of that. As part of phase three, as part of phase two, we had originally applied for and accepted a grant just to basically fund this position. And there was an understanding that enterprise itself would give an additional $30,000 to a not-for-profit to do a community outreach portion of this. They have slightly shifted the way that they are structuring the grant. Instead, the city will receive that $30,000, and we will look to have an outside organization. So my department is working on an RFP to look for that, but this is just to accept that additional $30,000.
Okay.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Terrific. Thank you, Ali. The next item number nine, we're applying for an ArtWorks grant on behalf of NACC.
So the Newburgh Arts and Cultural Commission has found this grant opportunity through the National Endowment of the Arts to conduct a arts and cultural survey.
Please go ahead. I'm just here for questions.
Okay. And they the application is in multiple phases, and so the first phase is due, I think, within a couple of weeks of now. The grant is for $35,000, but there is a match. The Arts and Cultural Commission is working to identify how the match will be funded. And while we talk about that, because there are some parameters that the commission needs to understand about how we do that as a city auspice, you know, as a city commission. So the resolution here is to allow them to make the application. And hopefully if they are awarded, you know, if they get through the process and they're awarded the grant, we will have identified the source of the match at that time, and then we can come back and ask you to accept it. So we have somebody, I'm sorry,
Yeah, I'm Naomi Miller, a recent resident and homeowner here, and also on the newly reformed Newburgh Arts and Cultural Commission. I think that you guys have the rough outline of what we're, the scope of the application. This, of course, is pending the resume of the government. The NEA is currently closed, as most many government offices are. So the deadlines that we're prepared for and preparing for might be delayed once it actually opens again. So this all is very contingent on that.
I mean, it sounds like a great project and a great idea, and so we want to make sure that if it's successful, that the source of the match is identified.
And so that's where I was going to go. So I guess I'll wait until a later time because I'm curious about the source, and I'm also curious about the parameters where it doesn't, because I'm hoping that you get it. At the same time, you know, fiscally, I'm hoping that it doesn't put us in a situation, but I'm sure that under Mrs. Kelson's leadership and under her direction that we won't be in that situation.
Yeah, this looks exciting.
Yeah, the idea is that we would get half of the grant and then we would match that through funding and the city wouldn't be responsible for it, that your sponsoring it basically would be contingent on that.
That's great.
Yeah, that's great.
And we're very excited to be applying to the NEA because if we actually, in the event that we do get it, it would bring a lot of attention to Newburgh and prestige in our community and cultural and community development communities as well.
It's amazing.
That's
amazing.
Great.
And then have you have this, well, this organization just got revitalized, and so thank you to Mayor Harvey for taking leadership on that.
Council
have you gotten Have you gotten any grants from them before?
I've been at organizations. I have about a 15-year experience in arts administration as well as being an artist. Nice. So I've written parts of NEA grants before, and I've applied to, I've even written an enterprise grant that you were talking about earlier. So I have a lot of experience with that.
Right, so good, because as a fellow grant writer, I know how that process can be. I also know that once you get a grant from them, it makes it easier to get other grants from
them. Yes, so I mean, we definitely also think of this as sort of a beginning of the process. It's not just, it can be a self-contained thing that leads to other things that offshoot of it, but I think it also could be a really great sort of first iteration mm-hmm. of bigger goals.
I agree.
Right. I just want to say that I'm really happy that you guys are really moving forward and you have a plan in place, and it's just really exciting to see this commission working.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, I'm,
also,
I'm.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to also say, share the same sentiments as Councilwoman Monteverdi, but also, really quickly, Joe and I had a very interesting meeting, and it's kind of non-connected to the grant directly per se, with some folks with the Illuminated Festival and them wanting to bring a piece of art to the city.
Huh.
And so at some point, if you could relay the message back to the commission that our city manager and I, under the direction of the Illuminated Festival committee, Paul Ernenwine and those guys want to make sure that you're involved.
Great.
With this really, really huge art piece
yeah.
that may possibly come to this to the city. Just keep that in mind. Right, Joe? Are we, okay. Yeah,
so. Yeah, we'd definitely love to know more about that.
Yeah, we don't want to put too much out there, but yeah.
Okay.
So, okay.
But it is big.
It's big, yeah.
It's a sculpture, right?
Yes.
Okay. Are there any questions? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for your
keep
time.
Up the great work with the commission.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very
and
much.
At some point, we're going to have a conversation about that 1% for art whenever Kelson is ready.
Well,
whenever she's ready.
We'll have a conversation when we get a controller on board.
Right. All that stuff
in place.
Right. Okay.
All right.
Thank you for reconstituting the commission.
Oh, man. It's all right.
Just
it's
in time for me to come in and join
it's
it.
An it's an honor.
Great.
It's an honor.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda, we're going to discuss the Best Resource Center, which is a workforce development agreement.
So Best Resource Center, Vera Best, has obtained grant funding, workforce development grant funding from the county. Over the summer, she had money to provide young people to perform temporary jobs over the summer. She apparently has additional grant funding that she wanted to continue through the cold weather seasons. So this is the same type of agreement that the council approved for summer youth employment with Best Resource Center. Mm-hmm. And now it's the same type of agreement where she'll supply the bodies as it, you know, for those who meet the criteria, 18 to 24 year olds, and for suitable positions working in our Department of Public Works and the Water Department. So it's just a letter agreement establishing we'll provide the positions and she'll provide the administration and the actual employees.
How many kids?
I'm not sure exactly what number she has right now. Mm-hmm. But again, it's an addition to what she has done over the summer.
Oh.
So.
And do George and Wayne have some say in hiring the people? Interviewing them and making sure they're is a good fit for them?
Yeah, when we interview, it'll be Vera, myself, sitting down, Wayne, and we bring the kids in, we interview them, so it works out well.
And they're going to work only during the summer?
No, this is for January. This is for the cold weather season. So this would be for January or what's left of January through June 30th.
So that's now.
Yeah, it's now. So she just approached me a couple of weeks ago, and this was the first opportunity that I had to get this in front of you. It's an expansion. Previously, she had only had it for the summer.
Yeah.
So this is an expansion. I expect that we'll be back here in, you know, late spring, early summer to do something additional for summer youth employment.
This is great.
So one of the things that Mr. Vandenberg and Mayor Harvey and I have been talking about was some of our properties and making that, building some of those houses and some of those other things. This won't cover that, correct?
Did you say building houses?
Not building houses, but it's a...
We talked about the little park project.
Right,
Yeah. No, my staff will take care of that. Mm-hmm. But you know, obviously, anything with the water department or car is really hard to fill. So anytime I get youth in, I mean, that's kind of why we do our tours. They tell me to get youth in to, you know, to see the plant, open their eyes, and see that view. You know, obviously, we do it. So, you know, George and myself will definitely use this as a recruiting tool.
Okay.
We can do a lot of things with building houses.
Yeah, I misspoke on the building houses. I meant...
Okay, good. You scared me there. I was like, what?
Hey, youth build.
Okay, moving forward. Item number 11, we have an ordinance to change the name of the Parking and Transportation Advisory Committee to the Transportation Advisory Committee.
So this came at the request of the committee itself. In the code... It is listed as the Parking and Traffic Advisory Committee, even though the body of the chapter refers to it as the Transportation Traffic Parking and Advisory Committee. So they wanted to shorten and streamline the name is what I'm getting. And so I've tried to set it up so that not only is the substantive name of the name changed in the substantive body of the ordinance, but also in the title. And I'm hoping General Code Publishers will amend both. So that's it's just kind of a housekeeping item. And
question, it doesn't change the fact that they're going to also, I mean, they're going to continue to work on a parking plan, correct?
I think transportation is a broad enough term that we're not changing the mission. And so if you look at section 71-1B, among the function and duties of the Transportation Advisory Committee would be to evaluate and make recommendations on various issues, including but not limited to parking, traffic, transportation, alternative transportation modes, bike, pedestrian, and cycling. So we're not changing their mission.
Okay.
They just want a more streamlined name.
How many members do they have, and when do they meet?
It is, there's up to six residents. City residents. It's a total of nine members. There are up to six residents. one representative of an agency who advocates on behalf of persons with disabilities, and then two city staff members. The current city staff members are actually also city residents. So we have Chad Wade from the Engineering Department and Allie Church from the Planning and Development Department. So, and Councilman Grice also likes to attend and participate.
Right. And then I do want, and so part of the thinking is exactly what you said, Mrs. Kelson, is to make the name more streamlined so it still does include those other things. Another thing that I do want to mention for the people that are on Facebook is that the Transportation Committee does have a Facebook page. You could join as a member. They are very interactive, and they post interesting information. They take surveys. They do other things to get that community input. So if you get an opportunity, please join their group.
When do they meet?
And they meet on the Wednesday. It's every second Wednesday. What is it?
Yes, I believe.
Every second Wednesday at 123 Grand Street, usually, and it's, at 6 o'clock.
Was it the day before our meeting?
Yes.
Work session.
Work session.
Thank you. Next item, we are going to have the chief discuss our video surveillance program.
Thank you, Chief.
So in reference to the surveillance cameras that are placed throughout the city, there's 34 cameras in total. Out of the 34, 33 are functioning. One is not functioning, and we're still doing some diagnostics on that to see if we're going to be able to repair that or not. If not, we may have to replace it. Overall, though, the system is working very well. Well, I don't want to disclose exactly, you know, the placement of the cameras. The cameras have been strategically placed along those areas that have been identified as long-term hot spots as far as crime goes. 2 to 3 years ago, 19 cameras were installed in-house by our IT department, and about a year ago, another 13 were installed by CIA security. Like I said, the whole system at this point is functioning well. It's very useful as a law enforcement tool, as well as a deterrent. You know, combining that with ShotSpotter and our other crime-fighting initiatives, you know, collectively has what is driven the crime rate to historic lows at this point.
So, Chief, really quickly, would you suggest, or do you think we should look for funding for additional cameras?
Sure. There have been four areas that I've been identified where cameras would be useful. Two of them are in the southeast quadrant of the city, and a couple on the west end.
Gotcha.
So I did sit down with Nick, and I know you and Nick, Mayor, had a conversation about that, and we looked at a couple different areas. Me and him mulled over the map for a while, and we did identify some additional areas where cameras could be useful.
Okay.
We'll be sitting down with the city manager, and we have a meeting with Senator Skoufis, I think, in a week or two.
Oh, good.
So we'll be looking for funding for a number of different things, and that's certainly something we'll be looking to explore.
Also, they kind of walk back on the speed cameras for the schools. I don't know why, but they were ready to launch that as soon as the guys, State Senator Skoufis and Assemblyman Jacobson, got sworn in. So we want to try to follow up on that, because I know that's going to put more eyes on the street. Even though the purpose of it is to catch people speeding in those school zones, but, you know, a camera's a camera, so.
I don't know a lot about the speed camera situation, but okay. I would suspect that is more of a complicated issue than you might think, just for a number of different reasons. But I just jotted that down, and that's certainly something.
Yeah, because they have funding for it.
Yes, so. We'll certainly look at that.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, real quick, any rough estimate on where, because there was a report and several people called me, some of our council members, called, it looked like News 12 ran a story this week about crime or Newburgh being identified as one of the dangerous cities in the nation. And you know, our crime has been going down. I know in 2018, we almost went the entire year without any homicides until the very end, a couple of days before the election, unfortunately. And I attended those services. But crime, can you give us any data that you know of where we are with crime?
Well, our violent crime is the lowest has been in decades or more. Okay. We're in a process of setting up a press conference with the DA's office to get the actual numbers out there. Right. It's very disconcerting that some of the news agencies have published some
old data.
It's so misleading what they're doing.
It's misleading data from websites that are not accurate. Nobody has contacted me or anybody else from the police department prior to putting these releases out, so it befuddles me why they didn't even do that.
Yeah, and that was just a few days.
Story.
Yeah, it was old data. It was online. It was News 12. People tagged me on it, and it was a newspaper article the week prior. So this was just 3 days ago that News 12 ran this. Okay, so this is like on Tuesday, Monday or Tuesday. It was on News 12. I called Joe immediately, and he and I had a discussion because I actually was at a luncheon on Tuesday with the Greater Newburgh Rotary Club, and they basically had questions regarding our crime and where we are with business and development and infrastructural changes. So they had some great questions, but you know, when I gave them the data and the statistics on where we are with crime being down, someone mentioned to me that this News 12 report came out, and then it was an article that came out prior, and I was like, that's old data. And so, you know, it's unfortunate because, you know, we don't want that perception to slow down or prevent us progress from developing and our progress and our revitalization efforts and attracting homeowners and business owners.
Correct. And I did have a conversation with the district attorney about either getting out a press release collectively we had decided that just sending out a press release is just kind of, you know, throwing paper out there at it, where having a real press conference with all the stakeholders involved. Yep. The National Network for Safer Communities that's spearheading group violence initiative and whatnot, having everybody together, right, and really hammering a statement home is what will give us the most bang for our buck. So
yep,
that we'll be scheduling that within the next day or so.
Excellent.
Quick question. The report that you sent us on the 15th, which had the statistics, is that on the website?
That is not.
Can we put it on the website? It should be public.
Sure.
I think people need to see that.
Yeah, I don't see any reason why it can't be, but let me just vet that a little bit further, and I'll get it on the website as quickly as possible.
Thanks.
And so what I was going to say for the public that are here and the ones that are listening or, you know, that might read this later, our crime rate is not what it was reported as in that article or on that news station. We are actually at a historic record. I think it's like a 10-year low for our crime rate. That's due to a lot of factors: ShotSpotter, cameras, good police work, and
community
also to
policing.
Residents.
Yeah.
So I want everyone to hear that loud and clear. That is not Newburgh. We are actually in a great position.
Right.
While I'm sitting here, I know I mentioned this before, but we have been in the process of rebranding our anti-crime unit to the Community Progressive Response Team with a different mission statement, which is more in line of the philosophy where the rest of the department's going. So at an upcoming work session, I'll be giving you a presentation regarding how that unit is going to work and how they're going to function and how they'll better serve the community at this point in time.
Thank you. Excellent. Thank you.
I do have a question concerning the overtime in the police department. Did we make our goal for the end of 2018 of saving that 100,000? I think it was 118,000 we were supposed to save.
Well, that one sergeant promotion that was made was slated to save, I think it was 113 or $114,000. Like, and I've been having talks with the manager about, you know, ways to, what we have to do next as far as, you know, solving some of the overtime and the comp time problems. But it's not going to be easy, and it's not going to be quick. But we're looking at a bunch of different things.
Right. Now, are you guys using the time clock or the finger scan for?
Some of the civilian employees use that.
I'm sorry?
Some of the civilian employees use that. Not the
civilian
police officers themselves.
So, I don't know. We just have to get better with that.
It's a collective bargaining issue.
Accountability.
It's a collective bargaining issue.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's been an issue for the 3 years that I've been, so I think instead of avoiding the problem, I think we have to address it. That's all.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you, Chief.
Yeah, Chief, I hope we can release this because this says it all.
Yeah, I just want to take another quick look at it and just converse with my folks, that should be fine for public consumption.
It'll deal with the fake news.
The fake news.
Thank you, Chief. Lastly, at the mayor's request, Ali has prepared a year-end summary of the city properties that we have sold.
Thank you.
Yep.
That's a
good report.
That's
oh, yeah.
It
should be on the
Thank
website.
You.
Yeah. If you
have
an extra copy.
Put that on social media tonight. He said he'd find out if he can. Oh, yeah, right. You have an extra one? Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Down here. Do you want?
The last page in your packet.
Are you sure?
There's two pages.
Thanks, Allie.
Do you have them?
Yes. It's in the. Yeah, it should be. There it is.
I don't have it.
You don't?
Thank you. I got it.
So a little bit of a short notice, so I only have the list. I would be happy. In the past, we've, with a little more lead time, we've done some of the breakdown, but I've pulled some numbers for you all just quickly. So in 2018, and just to clarify, these are properties that closed. So obviously you pass a lot of resolutions. We actually have almost 10 that are 2019 sales at this point. That just means those have closed in 2019.
Nice.
We don't consider it sold until it's closed. So 49 properties were sold to 45 individual buyers. Of those 20, or 44%, the owner intends to live there. So that was a big priority of 2018, that council directed us to look for a lot more owner occupants, and we did. Additionally, to look for a lot more people in Newburgh. So again, of those 45 buyers, 19 or 42% list Newburgh, New York as an address. We also started a new program last year, as you well know, to use River Realty to sell some of our higher value properties.
What's the name of that again?
River Realty.
Right.
And so their contract was late in the year, so you'll see those are at the end of the list. In 2018, they sold 6 properties. However, the big thing that I want to point out with that is, so the reason to have River Realty was to increase the sales price. So overall, the average sales price for properties was just over $31,500. Wow. However, for those 6 River Realty properties, the average sale price was $64,483. So more than double. They are higher value properties, but we also are hoping that we're being more successful in getting the best sales price for using the River Realty. A quick comparison to years past. So these are just years. So remember, prior to 2013, the city sold properties at auction. So that was a very different process. So just looking forward.
How many auction?
At auction, I don't know. The auctions were held not every year. And some years it was a bunch, and some years it was a few. It was just basically when the auction.
The city hasn't held an auction, I think, probably since 2012 or 2013.
I believe 2012.
We definitely have none in 2018.
No, absolutely not. No, absolutely not.
But how many of those that from the auction, I from what I understand, we took back a lot, right?
It's a very complicated large spreadsheet that I'm happy, what we call our reverter list. Basically has, it's complicated. A good amount came back. What happened with a lot of the times at the auction is they were either sight unseen, so the person didn't really know what they were getting into. Sometimes properties, they would get, really want one, but the auction had bundled a few, so they got two that they didn't want. So they kept the one.
Yeah, we did that in a sealed bid sale. So the city's experimented over the years with various methods of property disposition. If you start with the first duty is to the taxpayer, then the sale has to go at public auction to the highest bidder as your only criteria. We have come to learn over time that there are other things that are important and relevant to the city besides the bottom line purchase price.
Like having the money to fix it up.
Exactly.
Right. Having the money to actually renovate it.
And the experience.
Continuing to sustain the renovated property and pay the taxes and be on the tax rolls. And in various iterations, you know, the city's tried numerous other methods of disposition to achieve other goals, which is to encourage owner-occupants, to encourage renovations, and to eliminate blight.
And then, you know, I'll add on top of that, as I shared with the mayor, I am working on draft disposition policies, so just really writing up how we are currently doing our property sales, the huge method of property sales, so the realtor, internal, obviously transfer to the land bank, which you heard a lot about, and then ultimately RFPs too. Right. And so we'll start a community discussion, I hope, in February.
Ellie, can you give us a number, and hopefully you have this information, how many properties do we actually,
It ebbs and flows tremendously. Right now we have very few. And to clarify, these are properties that we consider in surplus, right? We own City Hall. That's not a surplus property.
So we're talking about properties that are not being used for municipal purposes.
Right. And so we take them once a year, right? And we have not taken yet this year. So we're at we have between 20 and 30, I believe, right now, because we've transferred all the ones to the land bank that the land bank wants, and we haven't taken new ones, and we've sold a bunch. So we're at a really low point. That will go up.
That's good.
That's good.
Yes,
right?
But to clarify, it's just a lot of factors. We're at the low point of the year.
That's great.
So
May 31st is, we'll What's be taking number? A lot more.
It's May a Hawaii 31st year, so. The 2016 tax foreclosure proceeding has been commenced and service has been made. And we're in the redemption period. That redemption period concludes at the end of May, and then we'll have an idea of how many properties remain at risk of being subject to a judgment of foreclosure in which the city would take title. So my expectation is, we will have an idea sometime in June. We won't have title probably till close to the end of the summer by the time we submit the papers and the judge actually signs the papers and allows us to record a deed. Last year we did not acquire a significant amount of properties. It's one of the smallest judgments of foreclosure that we've had in a long time, and I kind of expect that trend to continue.
Great. But so in judgments of foreclosure that we currently own, the deeds to is 220 properties.
That's not what Allie said.
We have about 220 properties.
We have that aren't committed to projects that we have available for sale is between 20 and 30 right now.
Right. Oh, 20 and 30.
Okay, yeah.
20 to 30.
I don't know the exact number.
Okay, because I guess, you know, because tonight is one of those nights when we're trying to misspell all these, you know, numbers that are out there, right?
Right.
So, you know, for the record, because it always gets floated, the city of Newburgh owns, you know, on the foreclosure list, right, 700 properties.
So the list of delinquent taxes, which is a public document, it gets recorded in the county. So the list of delinquent taxes may have several hundred properties on that. But people do come in and pay their taxes, people come in and redeem, and at the end of the day, last year in the 2015, out of however many hundreds of properties were on the list of delinquent taxes, the city only acquired title to, I think, it was under 40. All right. So yeah, I don't, you know, the expectation and the trends are, I'm expecting to be in that ballpark again this year based on economic and trends. So we're not, you know, I don't expect the city to have title to hundreds of properties in 2019. That's not the expectation at all.
And so I would add, one of the numbers that people often mix up is they say that the city has 700 vacant properties.
That's
the
what
city
I was
does
say.
Not. Yeah,
where did they get that number from?
Yeah. There are about, so we keep that in the codes department. We have a staff person, Ms. Hollins, goes out and counts vacant properties. From that, we are around the 600 to 700 mark of properties in the city that we believe
that
are currently
vacant.
The city does not own most of those. They are owned by various.
Or the bank.
They could be bank owned, they could be privately owned, but at the end of the day, not every vacant property in the city belongs to the city. As Ali said, right now, we probably have less than 30 of those kinds of properties that the city is ultimately owning.
So common misconception are that, you know, the fire department puts the X's and the slashes on. That has nothing to do with ownership.
They think that is, so that's just an urban myth.
Right.
Do those people get fines?
So the city has a vacant property registry and a fee that people are required, and again, a staff person that we have that actually enforces it quite well. They're required to pay annually an escalating registration fees, and they're required to put up a bond for the maintenance of the property. So basically, if they don't maintain the property, we could pull the bond to maintain them. If they follow all those rules, they wouldn't get fined. They are following our rules. There are, gave you a position earlier for someone to look at neighborhood stabilization. We absolutely have a distressed property issues continuing in the city, and we have properties that that have significant fines, and Corporation Council spends significant time in court dealing with. So
right. So if they're not following the rules, then we try to bring the enforcement proceedings. Those proceedings are resolved in city court. One of the things that I discovered in last year or so is that there was state legislation passed that allowed the cities of Buffalo and Syracuse to re-levy their unpaid building code fines. And I would advocate that that's something that should be available to maybe all cities who incorporate and have to do their own distressed properties and their own tax foreclosure proceedings.
I would agree.
What it would do is, if building code fines could be re-levied, it would raise the priority of those liens ahead of other liens on the property, and the city would end up being able to
recoup some
of that money a lot quicker.
So is that a resolution that we?
It's something that we could talk to our legislative representatives to see if there is some movement in the state legislature to expand that possibility to other cities in New York State. And if that would be the case, if we need to make a home rule request, we would bring that home rule request to the council to approve.
Right. Now, one other thing, I know, Michelle, you and Jeremy were working in 2018 on that legislation where the city can actually take abandoned properties that are privately owned, that haven't been remediated over a long period of time.
So there is a provision in state law. It's Article 19 of the Real Property and Actions and Proceedings Law that allows municipalities, if certain conditions are met, to bring a court proceeding to acquire title. And so kudos to Jeremy Kaufman, who's been really taking the initiative here on this work. We got judgments today for two properties on Johnson Street. So we're going to be seeking an application to the sheriff's department to facilitate the transfer of a sheriff's deed so we could take title to those properties. So he's been very aggressive and utilizing that tool. And so there's two more properties that we'll be able to now reconvey out to somebody who can do something with them and improve Johnson Street.
Yeah, and I know there were a couple that happened in last year as
well. Yeah, there were two that acquired. Those two were transferred to the land bank. And that was one that was on South Miller Street, and I believe one on First Street, I want to say. So that's a tool that's been out there for a while. Mm-hmm. But this is really the first opportunity that we've been able to successfully use it.
And I would reiterate that they were transferred directly. Often we're using this method not to take properties so they can just sit in our inventory. Right. We do them as part of a project for a third party. Right. So we know that they will be redeveloped almost as soon as we take title to them.
That's amazing. Those are victories. Those are great victories. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Good job.
Great. Thank you. If there's nothing further, we can adjourn the meeting.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah.